Hi, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin this evening, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the ancestral lands of the Suquamish, the Duwamish, the Muckleshoot, and all the signers of the Pointe Elliott Treaty. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for the stewardship of this land. Welcome to this evening's event with Jill LaPointe and Sasha LaPointe. Tonight's program is presented in partnership with Elliott Bay Book Company, and we're very grateful to tonight's event sponsors, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, Seattle City of Literature, and the Seattle Times. We've been celebrating Native and Indigenous authors all this month as part of our Seattle Reads programming. We're reading There, There by Tommy Orange, and we have one more event later this month with the brother and sister writing illustrating team, Keith and Chenoa Agawa. They'll talk about their book for kids, The Whale Child, next week on October 27th at 2 p.m. You can learn more about that event at our website, www.spl.org. Tonight, after Jill and Sasha's presentation, we'll have time for your questions. You can type your questions at any time during the program. Just use the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen. We may not have time for all of the questions, but we'll get to as many as we're able. I also wanted to mention, for those of you who might enjoy using this, we have closed captioning available tonight. Also at the bottom of your Zoom screen, there's a little button that says CC, and if you click that, you can access the closed captioning. Now, I'm delighted to welcome this evening's guests. Jill LaPointe is director of Lushootseed Research and granddaughter of Vi Hilbert. Sasha LaPointe is a Coast Salish author from the Nooksack and Upper Skagit tribes. She received her MFA from the Institute of American Indian Arts with a focus on creative nonfiction and poetry. She is the great-granddaughter of Vi Hilbert and her namesake. Sasha's memoir, Red Paint, is forthcoming from Counterpoint Press in 2022, and we just learned that there will also be a new book of poetry that year as well, something to look forward to. Tonight, Jill and Sasha will be talking about Vi Hilbert's Haboo, a collection of 33 stories and legends of the Lushootseed-speaking people of Puget Sound. Upper Skagit tribal elder Vi Hilbert received a National Heritage Fellowship from the National Endowment of the Arts in 1994, taught language classes at the University of Washington, and co-wrote the Lushootseed Dictionary. Her collection, Haboo, has recently been redesigned and re-released from University of Washington Press, featuring a new foreword from Jill LaPointe. This collection is an invaluable resource for linguists, anthropologists, folklorists, future generations of Lushootseed-speaking people, and others interested in Native languages and cultures. Please help me welcome Jill LaPointe and Sasha LaPointe.
Dhwal Gulapu, Gulapu Deishan, Ubut Bulachibi Tubushad Chan, Jill Siskokwash LaPointe Sista, Lois Yapantuk Dodson, Sista Atsid Koi. Ibats Chud Atsi Tutakshablu, Vi Hilbert. Tul Al Chud Nooksack Gul Skagit. Utigwi Tubushad Chesh, Dhwal Ti Sush Elap Altia Ha Tlachel. Good evening, and thank you very much for inviting us to spend some time with you this evening. I raise my hands, we raise our hands to each and every one of you, thanking you for being here with us. I shared my ancestral name, Siskokwash, and also shared the name of my mother, Lois Yapantuk Dodson, and that I'm the granddaughter of the late Tuxhablu Vi Hilbert. As said, I'm from the Nooksack tribe and also Upper Skagit descendant. We are so thankful that you are here with us tonight. And tonight I'd like to share the foreword to the second edition of Haboo. When Haboo was first published 35 years ago, The dramatic art of traditional storytelling in many of our Native American communities was fading as younger generations became more adapted to mainstream culture and values. Recognizing the impact cultural change taking place in their communities, my grandmother, like so many other elders, sought to gather and preserve as much traditional information and wisdom as possible. Every elder who contributed to this magnificent collection of cultural stories did so in hopes that someday future generations will once again appreciate the art of storytelling. Although much has changed over the years, there remains one fortunate constant. Despite all the technological advancement since the first publication of Haboo, our communities continue to lose many of their beloved elders. As each year passes, we are left with fewer and fewer among us who can still recite the ancient stories, and even fewer who can retell the stories in our traditional Lushootseed language. Confronting this reality remains as critical to survival of Coast Salish culture and language today as it was 30 years ago. The wisdom and teachings found in Haboo continue to offer a pedagogical resource that highlights a way of being in the world that we have strayed from, and they remain as relevant today as they have been for generations. Growing up, my brother Jay and I heard our grandmother, by Taksha Blue Hilbert, tell many of the stories included here over and over again. Staying true to who she was, she never explained the meaning or revealed the overall lessons hidden in the stories, but rather she instructed us to think about each story and ask ourselves, what is this story trying to tell me? It wasn't until years later that I gained a deep appreciation for the traditional art of storytelling, as I heard Grandma repeat to audiences everywhere, young and old, that Lushootseed never insults the intelligence of a listener by explaining the story, allowing them the same dignity that her elders allowed her to find their own interpretation and understanding. Over the years, I have personally found this to be true insofar as my own encounters with the stories have remained fluid, growing with me, teaching me something new about myself as life brings me new experiences. I've been perplexed by some stories for years, only to realize that the lessons within are unveiled over time, bit by bit, in accordance with my own physical and spiritual location in life at any given time. The Lushootseed language and culture arose from the oral traditions of the Puget Sound Coast Salish people. It wasn't until the late 1960s and early 70s that Lushootseed was developed into its current written form. It's important to appreciate this, given how easily technological advances allow us to access information. Today, finding the answer to nearly any question or learning about something new is as simple as saying Google, Alexa, or Siri. Since the advent of the internet and rapid development of smartphones, nearly limitless information is available at our fingertips. Nearly all the tribal communities throughout the Puget Sound have language revitalization programs that are dedicated to websites, YouTube, and smartphone applications to promote their cultural languages. Any person with a computer or smartphone can start learning Lushootseed. I have no doubt that my grandmother would not only be amazed, but be excited about how technology has furthered the preservation and promotion of Lushootseed language and culture. However, it's also important to acknowledge how technology has changed the way we process information into knowledge that can enhance the quality of our lives. Long before Lushootseed was developed into a written language, the ability to listen carefully and remember what you heard was intrinsic to the longevity and continuity of all the important Coast Salish cultural teachings. Everything from family lineages and cultural traditions to spiritual and religious praxis, as well as our creation stories, which provide us an ontological understanding of our place and role in creation. These were entrusted to minds and memories of the listener, especially those who excelled in developing their minds, such as my grandmother's Aunt Susie Sampson Peter. For countless generations, the safeguarding of all this information depended not only on our ability to develop extraordinary memories, but more importantly, our ability to listen attentively. Lishoyo de chu quad hutch. Make yourself single-minded to avoid confusion. This was a saying that my great Aunt Susie Sampson Peter used to say. Lishoyo de chu quad hutch. Moreover, development of these skills and abilities extended far beyond the preservation and transfer of information. They played a crucial role in our ontological purview. Understanding our place and role in creation was shaped through our ability to listen and learn from creation in all its forms. My grandmother often repeated a common phrase that she learned from her elders, in particular Martin J. Sampson. Zech duh ugusash tiat swaftivted. The earth is our first teacher. For countless generations, our ancestors sought guidance from Mother Nature by listening carefully to all the teachings she had to offer, revealing to each person their vocation, as well as moral guidance in how we are to conduct ourselves in the world. As each generation passes, our ability to listen carefully and remember accurately have faded. The skills of old continue to wane even further as technology relieves us of the historical necessity to memorize important information. Today, children are no longer required to sit patiently for hours listening to the old ones tell and retell our cultural stories. No longer are children required to listen as the elders teach us our family histories, lineages, or instill our spiritual and religious practices. All these vitally important teachings are Hachusida and Hwadik, the special information that guides us throughout our lives. What impact does the loss of such a rich and meaningful component of life have on the people or society? We're fortunate that our ancestors had the wisdom to foresee the tremendous change coming that would inexorably dismantle the world that they once knew so well. Although it broke their hearts to know that these changes would affect every aspect of Puget Sound Coast Salish culture and life, they remained willing and determined to seize any opportunity to share their wisdom through what Swinomish Elder Susie Sampson Peter called a different canoe, a tape recorder, so it could be captured and made available for future generations. We are also blessed by the foresight of scholars such as Dr. Pamela Amos, Sally Snyder, Tom Hess, and retired educator Leon Metcalf, whose fascination with the people and compassion for a dying culture led them to devote hundreds of hours traveling around the region, visiting different elders, and recording their wisdom, history, and stories. The stories in Haboo have so much to offer. They give each of us an opportunity to escape the seemingly unending technological bombardment of information and useless distractions streamed to us at high speed through our smartphones, laptops, and iPads, and television 24 hours a day. I encourage you to take a break, shut down your laptop, turn off the TV, put your phone on silent, and allow yourself some time to sit quietly with at least one of the stories included here in the story. Give yourself time to think about what unique meaning a lesson or story has for you. And if you feel ambitious, memorize it and share it with others. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to my daughter, Sasha LaPointe, who is carries the name of her great-grandmother, Taksha Blue, and would be so incredibly proud of her writing and storytelling in a contemporary world. So, yeah, help.
Hey, Thank you. Thank you for that beautiful introduction. And thank you for allowing us to share this space with you. It is an honor to be here and to be in some way in the presence of my great grandmother again and the beautiful work that she did. I am Sasha Takshablu Lapointe. As my mother said, I am my great grandmother's namesake. And growing up, she liked to introduce me that way. And what an intimidating introduction, you know, as a little kid, as a teenager, growing into adulthood, you know, she would always say, this is my namesake, and she's gonna do great things because she has to, because she's my namesake. You know, it was an intimidating way to be introduced by such an incredible woman. And as I grow older, I begin to know what that means a little bit more. I begin to understand it a little bit more. I mean, she's 100% the reason why I write and why I've adapted storytelling in my own way as a poet and a nonfiction writer. You know, growing up, hearing her tell stories, you know, many of the stories in this book, I was so rich in that way. Like, I think when you're young, you don't know or appreciate how beautiful it is to be around that traditional storytelling and that language. And, you know, a lot of the stories in this book mean a lot to me simply because I spent so much time as a young kid listening to her tell them powerfully and beautifully. Even when she passed, I remember taking a recording, a CD out to the beach and just listening to it on repeat over and over. So the fact that this book is in the world again in its new edition is so wonderful because it's yet another way we can keep this wonderful work and these stories with us. So I have a big gratitude for that. I mean, how cool was it growing up as, you know, being a young kid and hearing my great grandmother recite stories around the fire, you know, telling basket ogres. It used to scare me so bad. I wouldn't even be able to like go to the outhouse by myself, you know, walk the trail in the woods because she told stories in such a wonderful way that they just got inside of you. I was massively influenced by her and constantly tried to impress her. I think at like 6 or 7, I sat her down just super intent on doing my best to emulate her and to share a story with her. And so I sat her down and I told her from start to finish the entirety of The Little Mermaid, because I was obsessed with The Little Mermaid. I was 6, you know. And I thought I would be a storyteller, and she graciously sat there for however long it took, listening to line by line the entire movie. And she nodded and she smiled and kind of, you know, gave me that, okay, you tried, great-granddaughter, you tried. And then she shared with me, I'll never forget the first time I heard the Maiden of Deception Pass story, and it really stayed with me, you know. She kind of listened to me, took it in, realized her great-granddaughter was obsessed with mermaids, and she said, you know, in our culture, we have our own Maiden of Deception Pass. And I just thought, again, that's so cool. Like, my great-grandmother is basically the coolest person alive. I was really, really, really taken with her. And I think that those stories she shared with me show up in my own work so frequently. The Basket Ogress is constantly a trope within my work. The Maiden of Deception Pass shows up in my work. I think even in my younger, must have been in late teens maybe, she and I had a conversation at one of our family gatherings, and I was, you know, feeling lost as teenagers do and wondering what it was I was going to do. And that night, my great-grandmother gifted me this huge, clunky word processor or typewriter, some kind of machine that exists in between those two things. And I took it home and I knew that I wanted to be a writer. And it's still sitting in my little writing studio today. She's with me, and she absolutely guides the work that I try to do, the things I try to explore within my own storytelling. And I feel very grateful for that. So I thought today, given that my great grandmother definitely pushed me in her gentle, her firm but gentle way into the work that I do now, that I would share with you a couple poems before turning it back over to my mom to close us out. So yeah, I'll share a couple poems from the upcoming collection. And I tried to choose poems that I thought, my great grandmother's in my work so much, definitely in the memoir, but she's constantly showing up in these ways. And so I chose a few poems to share tonight that she's definitely in. The canoe my grandmother gave me. When my grandmother hit the record button on the cassette player, it startled my great aunt. What is it? What does it do? It's going to capture the language, my grandmother said, to keep it. My great aunt thought about this for a long while. When she was a child, she traveled by river, by inland waters to relatives, to bring them fish, to carry the news. She looked down at the cassette recorder and nodded. Ah, she said, this is just a different kind of canoe. The last time we would eat together, we sat by a picture window overlooking the channel. She pushed fried oysters around her plate, Chardonnay pooling on white linen. At 6, I licked frosting bone white from China. My mother, embarrassed, reached for the plate. My grandmother slapped her hand away. Just let her enjoy it. And we rotated high above the city, the space needle spinning clouds into sugar. Now she looks over oysters, out past the docks. Remember when all of this was underwater? She points a greasy fork to the hill beyond the bridge. They kept the dead up there before they came and built a church. I see canoes high above a white chapel in branches of trees, no longer there. Speeding along asphalt, along LeConnor Whitney Road, the back seat sticky with whiskey, the smell of cow shit, of cut grass, I look out at the snaking body of water contained, curled and flexing to keep up. It was all underwater, she'd say, until they came and built dikes and farmhouses, planted fields just for tulips, stretching lakes of daffodils. With my head against glass, bottle of whiskey in my lap, I squint until the channel breaks free, until the roads are water again. Because when I woke to find him there, breathing heavy, blonde, 210 pounds of quarterback, of animated Coors Light above me, I learned to sever head from heart, dunked my head beneath water that was no longer there, to drown again and again, to breathe in river silt and mud, count silver scales of fish and all of the white pebbles rushing past. We learn to say, I just let it happen. We learn to use words in forgotten languages. I learned to hold my breath beneath the currents, unaware of the boat on the riverbank waiting there. I think that it's important to mention too, as my mom was mentioning, the lessons inherent within some of these stories that she worked so hard to share with all of us. Those lessons have been sort of, you know, passed down through stories to us, and in a way show up in my own work in these new ways. You know, if anything, my great grandmother taught me strength, and oftentimes, my work has heavy, heavy tones and represents different parts in my life that were challenging and heavy, but the presence of my great grandmother in them sort of reminds me of the strength that I carry within me, and the strength that she has sort of shared with me. And that's important. So I'll just read two more and then turn it back to you. Teach me to say I love you in your language. I have forgotten how to speak, like something caught in my throat, a fishbone broken, splintering me into something quiet. Muted and star-like, lost in a sky, the word for sky is shakulguets. Teach me to say, just stay, stay put, stay here, because I have forgotten how to be inside my own body, whatever my body has become beneath your tongue, conquered and ugly, malformed and mispronounced. Teach me a word better than survivor, like watching my great-grandmother pour black coffee in the kitchen and the stacks of legal pads filled up with her words, and I tried to listen. The word for language is guadguated. Teach me to say I love you, because every time I walk into a restaurant to meet a date, I hesitate. I remember the trees along Portland Avenue in their red bows, like gift packages on Christmas morning. This is to honor assault survivors. How my mother tied each one, hugging their bark in ribbon. And I think of this as he pulls the chair out, takes my jacket and pours the wine red into the glass and asks if I am hungry. Red is what I remember when I think of how he will take me home and have to learn how to unwrap me. Teach me to say I love you, because what good is a ribbon if it cannot hold us together where we have been broken? Teach me to speak in a language older than words, specifically the words of white men whose tongues touch everything. Quiet yourself and listen. O-O Shibitzicha. O-O Shibitzicha. Like a sigh I would make as a child, comfortable and safe. Then the thud of my heart as it beats in my chest, its thrum as it drums inside my rib cage. And I just have one more. Red paint. All it ever was, a blanket sagging off my shoulders in the smoke-thick night. Her hands as they scooped it up against the pounding of drums, how they thundered my limbs in storm song. The four stars I counted outside the only window like ghosts. The smoke as it escaped, leaving behind its orange glow, and the dancers cedar woven, my eyes falling heavy past 3 in the morning. And this is when she tells me the red paint is for healing. Thank you.
Thank you. So I plan to finish with a story that was known to many as Taksha Blue's signature story and told around the world to many different audiences and in correctional facilities and storytelling venues, New Zealand, England, New York, just everywhere. She went everywhere and shared this lovely story, but I would be remiss if I didn't say something about the new cover of Haboo. When University of Washington Press approached me and asked me about changing the artwork for the cover of this book, I looked through the collection of drawings and pieces of art that I was gifted by my late uncle, Ron Chadiskedub Hilbert, when he passed in 2006. And this This image was always one of my favorites because he did this image a lot. It's the eagle whose wings are outstretched, enveloping usually a family, and there's the Mount Rainier, Mount Tacoba, a snow-covered mountain in the background. And I particularly liked this one because there is what looks to me like an elder and a young person. And so I thought of the elder, maybe grandma, telling stories to her ebuts, her grandchild. And oftentimes when you spent time with Tuxedo grandma, she made you feel like you were the only person in the world right there. I mean, you had her attention 100%. And it reminds me of family, just the sacredness of family and the circle connecting us to all beings and how we're connected even when we're apart. And I imagine us sharing space tonight across the internet with a relative who recently came a part of our life, and that is the daughter of the late Ron Chodosgate of Hilbert, Casey Arreaz, who is on the East Coast and hopefully with us tonight. But she's a blessing because she's provided us with a connection, a tie to our beloved late uncle Chodosgate. And we thank him for his talent and providing these beautiful illustrations for the book. And inside the book, there's still the illustrations that he had shared before. And oftentimes he was criticized for sharing some of the scenes of longhouse or smokehouse winter dance ceremonies. And people said that's not to be shared, but my uncle believed in the importance of creating a snapshot of what the culture was about. And it didn't reveal any secrets, because if you did not know what was going on there for having never experienced it or participated in it, then you wouldn't know. But it was captured because they didn't allow cameras in this winter dance ceremony. So we are grateful for all of these treasures from the culture and the language that have been left by the storytellers who were willing to be recorded in this new canoe. And another Forward Talks shares a story about Susie Sampson, who is an elder who, for part of her life, she actually lived in the house that I'm speaking to you from, where I live with my husband. And she lived here many years ago, and her daughter-in-law, Betty Sampson, is the grandfather or the grandmother of my husband. And she said, Betty would say she could walk by Susie's bedroom and hear her telling stories to nobody. And one day she'd start to tell a story and say, oh no, I told that one yesterday. And so even though she had no audience, she would tell the story. So I would like to share with you now a story that was told by Elizabeth Grice from Tulalip in 1963 and recorded by Tom Hess, a linguist. And so this little story became a favorite of my grandmother's, and she shared this story, like I said, with hundreds of people around the world. So I'm going to share it with you now in Lushootseed and English. A slotlil kwasi bishad altiahi kala diai. Lady Laos lived there in a great big house all alone. Hui kwiguas yayas. She had no friends or relatives. Hoi quidada guheg all. So one day she took it, this great big house. Gu'u'ikwida, and she swept it. Kashtikwil. There was lots of dirt. Hoy udugui jilaf alti al. When she got to the very center of this house, hoy puela, she got lost. Shabshubaschad. And that was the end of Lady Louse, Dils Hois. And that is the end of the story. And you could say Haboo if you're listening. That's how we tell the storytellers that you haven't fallen asleep, you're paying attention, and it encourages the it encourages the storyteller to continue. So Lady Louse was thank you, Haboo. Lady Louse is such a treasure because over the years I thought of different Lady Louse stories to coincide with different places where I was at in my life. One such story from, I don't know, several years ago, I was working as a social worker and went something like Lady Louse was a social worker. And she worked long, long hours and helped many, 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 many people. And she had so much paperwork and so many forms, and she never took breaks and she never went to lunch, and she didn't have any friends, and she didn't have any time for any family, and didn't have any time to care for herself. She just worked and worked and worked and worked and worked and poured out for everyone else, and dealt with the red tape and bureaucracies. And finally, one day, she got to the burned out. And that was the end of Lady Louse. So something like that. But that was years ago. And today I have a different Louse story that is significant in my life. And one of Grandma's favorite Louse stories was a very short one. Lady Louse was a sponge. And one day she got self-absorbed. That was the end of Lady Louse. And that's the end of that story. Dis hois. Utigui to Busha Chad Twa Ti Sulakslup. And thank you for listening. That's all. If we have some time for questions.
That was wonderful. Thank you so much, Haboo. And I don't know if you saw, but a lot came in the chat. Thank you so much, Jill and Sasha. That was wonderful, and I actually loved the juxtaposition of the stories and the poetry. I think that was just beautiful to have both of those things together. Thank you for that. So for those of you watching, we have time for your questions now, and I see one in the Q&A now, so I'm gonna pop that up here. And so this one is from Christina asking, did you find it frustrating that she, I think meaning your grandmother, did not share the meanings but expected you to get the meanings for yourself? Was that frustrating for you?
There were some stories that I had mentioned in the foreword that I was perplexed for years. Like, what is the meaning of this story? I felt like I was intellectually challenged to the extreme, because I heard her tell the story hundreds of times and I just could not get it. So yes, years later though, an understanding came to me, and crystal clear. I was attending a program through Seattle University on pastoral leadership, and we were studying, it coincided with the story that I had been perplexed by for, probably a good 25 or 30 years. And all of a sudden, this moment happened.
Moment of clarity.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, sometimes you do have to sit with things, right? And they come to you. We have a comment here from Sharon saying, I first heard a tape of your grandmother reading these stories, and then I met Molly McGee, who knew your grandmother, and she in turn introduced me to Vi, and we spent an afternoon with her. It was a very special day in my life. It's a gift to listen to the two of you. Just wanted to share that as well. And then we have another question here from Harriet asking Sasha, who gave you your name? And I think maybe wondering about the namesake, and maybe you answered that earlier about your grandmother, but maybe do you want to talk a little bit more about that or?
Well, my great grandmother decided to give me her name, and so that she passed the name to me in a naming ceremony when I was very young.
Thank you. Yeah. So it looks like we have another question about the interpretation of the stories. Dave is asking, was there usually a rite or rite is in quotation marks, a rite or intended meaning to most stories, or were they purposefully open to be interpreted individually? For example, no right or wrong meaning.
You know, some of the stories are explanations. So, you know, there's a story about the seasons, and there's a story about the south wind. And so some of the different stories, there's not a whole lot of interpretation involved. It just is like a teaching. It's an education to share this story about. And there are creation stories, and many of the tribes in this area have a flood story. And one of my favorites is the Swinomish flood story, and those are not really as much about interpretation, just sort of as our history.
Thank you. We have another question or comment and question from Sharon. Sasha, I loved your poems. When will your book be out?
Thank you. The book, the collection of poems will be out with Milkweed Press in early 2022.
That's great. It looks like that's all the current questions we have, you know, and I'm wondering if the two of you want to talk a little bit more about the preservation of the language. Is there anything else you'd like to talk about around that and about what's being done now around Lushootseed? Or Jill, it sounds like your work centers on that, perhaps, the Lushootseed research. Would you like to speak about that a little bit?
I could definitely talk about the revitalization efforts of the Lushootseed language. Many, as I had mentioned in the foreword, there are quite a few tribes in the area who have very thriving and active language programs. And there's currently a survey that is getting a gauge as to how many speakers may be speaking the language. One of the things that there was an elder storyteller who spoke at Seattle Art Museum several years ago during a storytelling gathering, had made the comment that most anybody who learned or speaks Lushootseed now either learned it from Vi Hilbert or learned it from somebody who learned it from her. Mm-hmm. So yes, there's quite a few speakers now who maybe are learning it from somebody who learned it from somebody who learned it. So like at the grandchild level out. But yes, there's different models of, rather than a curriculum-based language teaching method to a speaker using the language and a number of different methods to speak the language and learn the language, but to apply it sort of across the board. So you're not just taking a language class and learning language, but some of the programs are incorporating teaching language through other, like incorporating it into science classes or math classes or, you know, whatever the regular study is that they're just incorporating it into the language into that, and which I think is a wonderful concept for teaching it. So it's coming along. It's definitely not at the edge of extinction like it was for many, many years. And we, you know, do hold a debt of gratitude to the elders who, you know, had that foresight to be recorded. And it's really important too, to continue for, you know, young people to continue recording and gathering the wisdom and the knowledge of the ones who are with us, who still have information, whether it's about language or our, you know, spiritual beliefs or practices, our gathering of medicines and use of plants and all of those things that are so important, because the Lushootseed language is, it's a spiritual language. And sometimes it is described as, you know, English jabs and Lushootseed caresses. Which I thought was a lovely way to think about that. And it's also a language that's evolving, you know. When the way that we use the language and the way that we share stories changes over time, but that's true with any language that evolves over time. Something that meant one thing 20 years ago, the same word has a different, more expanded meaning, maybe now. But the language and the stories were our guide for how to conduct ourselves. And I think that, you know, really when I talk so much about how we have the high speed access to technology and internet, that one of the things that breaks my heart is that, you know, we have forgotten how to communicate with one another. You know, we've forgotten a lot of the etiquette and gentleness in how we share and communicate. And I'm guilty of it as well, you know, but every now and then, you know, it saddens me to know that rather than going through the pleasantries and niceties and the caring that comes across, it's always a interesting when I share an email or something with my husband before I send it, and then he'll stop and be like, oh no, you're just too curt and abrupt, and it's like, oh well, you know, but that's, we just get to the point. And my grandmother always said, you know, just stick to the bullets, because it was very annoying to her, people who would go on and on and on and on and on and just talk forever and say, repeat themselves, and she would say, just stick to the bullets, just give them the bullets. And so I remember that and try to figure out, how do you balance sharing what is important and what needs to be heard and come out versus rambling on or just cutting it off too short so that you really don't share or say enough. And I think that's a struggle that I will probably have for many years to come. I'm going to turn it over to Sasha and see if she has anything else to. Oh, except I have to share one short story about Sasha. Grandma always knew she was going to be a storyteller. When she was 3 years old, I took her to Denny Hall at the University of Washington, where Grandma was teaching this literature class. She used the Haboo book and taught the original Haboo book and taught the class, and the students had to read every story and provide their interpretation. It was a challenging and wonderful class. But she invited Sasha to come to class one day, and I set this little three-year-old up on the podium in front of, I don't know, 150 or so students, and she sang songs and told little stories, and Grandma was just delighted. So it was just meant to be. And when she held her and passed her name on, I think she really knew something that that none of us knew at the time. So, Sasha, you out? Oh, looks like there's some questions. Are there any new questions?
There are some new questions. If Sasha doesn't have anything else she'd like to add at this moment. Okay. So we have a few questions here, and a lot of folks are very interested to know a little bit more about Lushootseed. One person is asking if there's, if there's, who is it that speaks Lushootseed, I think is the main thrust of the question here. And so is that something that, is it particular tribes or is it the Coast Salish folks? So.
Sure. So Lushootseed is part of the larger Salish language family, but the actual Lushootseed language is spoken from about as far north as the Samish tribe and Upper Skagit, Swinomish, Tulalip, Snohomish, Snoqualmie, all the way down to Nisqually, Puyallup, Muckleshoot, and Suquamish. So the tribes that really, and that's why we continue to say the Puget Coast Salish, because it's the, if you say Coast Salish, then that will include a much larger group. Okay. But the Lushootseed speaking tribes are right within the interior coast Puget Sound area. And there were quite a few dialects back in the old days. And now there's more or less a northern Lushootseed and southern Lushootseed. So anything south of, south of Snohomish speaks southern dialect. But they're very similar. There's a lot of similarities, and people were generally able to converse across the northern and southern dialects.
Thank you. Yeah. One other question is wondering, are there folks that learn Lushootseed as a first language, or are most speakers learning it now as a second language due to the impacts of colonizers and that history?
Yes, as near as I know, there are no longer any first language Lushootseed speakers. It's a second language or learned language.
But that wonderful web that you described, that by Hilbert was able to help expand. So now there's a web of speakers that are learning it now through time.
And, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
There was many other elders, that helped her with that work. She definitely, could not have done it all on her own.
Yeah.
And she spent a lot of time with more fluent elders during her years of gathering this information, because there was portions that, she had forgotten over the years of living a very acculturated life, in living in the city of Seattle and so forth. So many elders contributed hours with her, helping her, and Tom Hess with and Don Bates and the others who were involved in creating the dictionary and preserving the language. So she was, I think, the one who gathered it and carried it all together and really dedicated her life to that. And what Lushootseed Research as a nonprofit currently does is nowhere near the level of time and dedication that my grandmother put into it. We have all of the materials available, and we'd like to provide a central resource for people who are interested in getting access to Lushootseed materials, cultural materials, any number of the books that were gathered and transcribed and translated and written are available, and language tools, and we just keep adding to that collection as other language programs want to contribute their materials. So that we sort of have a central hub for sharing that. And then every year, once a year, we host a Lushootseed language conference where speakers and teachers and just curious people attend that has been hosted through Seattle University for the last 10 years. And this year, our 11th year, due to COVID, we held our first virtual conference, which just happened this past Saturday. And it was it was very well attended. And I was very pleased with it. I've had some positive feedback from people who attended, and the work that the tribes, the Suquamish tribe and Snoqualmie tribe and Puyallup tribe and Tulalip and Sauk Suwatl all shared some wonderful information and exciting videos and presentations on the work that they're doing. So.
That's amazing. That's great. And it's such important work to preserve that and keep it building so that people can continue creating art and story with the language, you know.
Yes.
We, when we hosted Tommy Orange this past weekend, the program was opened by Kalina Lawrence, a wonderful Suquamish singer, but she closed the program with a hip hop song that's all in Lushootseed. And yeah, it was great. You know, it was awesome to hear sort of that collision, you know, of something that we maybe think of as traditional in this new format. So I could talk to you all day, but there are more questions, so I'm gonna do my job as a moderator here. Sasha, this one is for you. Somebody says your poetry is so lovely, and I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about the relationship between your great-grandmother's stories, the oral tradition, and your experience writing poetry. Do you see connection between oral and written story?
I do, yes, and thank you. I think that from a very young age, hearing my great-grandmother, I mean, if you haven't seen her speak or heard her speak, it's something amazing to behold. There was this beautiful attention to like sound and cadence. I mean, she was just an extraordinarily gifted storyteller. And I think growing up with that, like I had mentioned, I just felt so lucky and so rich in this like knowledge, like constantly being around it. But I think in later years, you know, obviously when I came to poetry and got all obsessed with Sylvia Plath, like you do when you're a teen and all of that, but I'd never gone to school for it until I was an adult. And when I went into my first poetry class, I think I definitely carried some of that with me. Like, I remember, I mean, I definitely wrote a bunch of bad poems, but there was something inherently, like, I think even one of my first teachers was like, oh, you have like an ability, like an ear, like for sound. And I think that that absolutely was connected to hearing the importance and the weight that my great grandmother put on speaking and sharing stories somehow transferred into my, like, I kind of appreciated what you were saying about the performer who did the hip hop in Lushootseed. That's amazing. I want to hear that. But in that same way, this like very contemporary way, like I somehow growing up, having her around my whole life and hearing that, and then sort of applying it to something that made sense to me and who I was. And so if that is a very roundabout, weird, rambly way to answer the question, I think that the being around the oral tradition absolutely played a role in why I love poetry and the sound.
I think that's a beautiful answer. That makes complete sense. So we have time for a couple more questions here. Natalie is asking, was time intentionally set aside to have story time with your great-grandmother, when you were recording, you know, stories using the recorder? Or were stories more spontaneously inspired by random circumstance? And I suppose it might just depend, right?
Yeah, well, when my grandmother went out and told, when she went out and gathered stories, it was, I think, very intentional. And she went with her recorder. And oftentimes, her recording, being recorded, telling stories was also very intentional. But she just routinely would share stories with us. And And we attended a lot of her storytelling gatherings.
Well, she's been so important in the community, and I think of her often when I'm walking through Seattle University because of her the beautiful garden there. And so, yeah, it's, I mean, she's been instrumental in bringing that all together, all of the work that all the elders have been doing. And so, you know, thank you for that, and thank you for continuing that work with the work that you're doing. I think we have time for one last question, maybe a short one here. Any memory of some of Vi's favorite books? Any favorite books or other storytellers?
Oh, well, definitely Buckwalza. Susie Sampson is just a cherished book that was her like manifesto or whatever. That was her dissertation and her life's work, and that is an incredibly beautiful story. And Susie was such an incredibly beautiful being. She used to share recordings of Susie telling stories in the classes when I was attending classes at UW, and I wish I could go back in time and spend time with her.
And is that a book that is in print still? Do you know?
It is. Okay. It is. It is available through Lushootseed Research website, and awesome. and you know, they're available by donation. There's suggested donations to keep the operation of the nonprofit, but they're suggested donations, and they are all available.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sasha, were you going to say something?
I just saw a quick question that said, yeah. Is there a documentary about your grandmother? And I thought we could answer that one super quickly.
Oh, there, sure, yeah.
Hatshutsuda, right? Yeah. So I just wanted to answer that because I was like, oh, that's a quick one. And if you want to see it, it's online, right, Mom? Vimeo?
Yes, and you can also contact us through we do have some copies available if people want the old fashioned DVD version.
Vintage.
Yes, old school.
Right. And we put Jonathan, who's one of our wonderful SPL staffers, has put the URL for Lushootseed Research in the web chat. So if you're looking for that, while you're watching.
Thank you. Daha dubs.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much. This has been such a wonderful evening, and I feel like we could just hang out and chat all night. I'm so appreciative of your time and your sharing of the stories and the poetry, and I am so, so looking forward to both of your books coming out soon, Sasha. And and would you like to say anything else in closing, or shall we bid everybody good night? What do you think?
Oh, well, I would like to say again, thank you for inviting us here and allowing us to share this time with you. And I'll end with the words that Grandma often ended with, which is "Ut igwi tubushadchash tuhwati su lakslap." Thank you for listening.
Thank you so, so much. I want to let folks know that if you're interested in reading Haboo, you can find it on the library's website, that's spl.org, or you can find it at our partner booksellers, Elliott Bay Book Company. They're open for limited browsing and curbside service. You can also order for delivery through their website. That's elliottbaybook.com. And I know that I'm going to get at least one copy because I think my mom would love this. So, you know, but don't tell her. Thanks so much for being here, you two. This is wonderful. I'd also like to thank tonight's sponsors, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, Seattle City of Literature, and the Seattle Times. And of course, thanks to all of you who are here tonight with us. And thanks again, Sasha and Jill, and we'll see you all next time.